I'm Roy.
I'm Yayun.
And I'm Holly.
And we're the NMR team.
An NMR sample is measured by a probe in the magnet. The probe transmits to and receives radio frequencies from the sample. In the case of solid-state NMR, the probe also tilts and rotates the sample. If something goes wrong, repairing the probe costs typically more than 10,000 euros and takes over 3 months, while the manufacturer, in our case Bruker, is trying to improve turnaround time. It is unacceptably long, although, in all fairness, it is exacerbated by customs delays that are not their fault. In the case of a solid-state probe, the sample is placed in a rotor and spun many thousands of times a second. Occasionally the rotor explodes, trashing the probe head. This happened to us recently, and Bruker kindly offered to send us the necessary parts, although at a not insignificant cost, of about half the normal repair price, and without any warranty. We took a big financial risk by repairing the probe ourselves, but in the end saved time and money. If you want to try this yourself, please understand that this is at your own risk, and we accept no responsibility.
This is a solid-state NMR probe, a CPMAS 4mm probe. The rotor exploded inside it, and basically destroyed the coil. So we're going to have to try and repair that coil today. The problem is it also damaged the stator that includes the holds the coil, so we're going to replace that as well. The first step is to remove the screws in the bottom and take the outer can off. There are two screws. And the can just comes straight off like that, and you see the probe head here. This is the damaged stator. If you look carefully, you might even see a crack here. And the coil itself is badly damaged, so we're going to first take it off and replace it. So this here is the stator with the coil in it here. What we're going to do is take these two screws off, and then we can detach this section and pull this free. On the back of the stator, two screws down here that are holding it. That is now free. The stator downwards, there's this pipe which is also going to be replaced. It ends up down here. And I just need to disconnect it. I need to disconnect here, probably easier if I heat it up first. The coil and the stator come in two different packages. So we'll start with the stator. I'm using gloves here so as to reduce the possibility of contamination. I don't know whether we're going to use it for anything like photon detection, but the lipids on the skin can show up in magic angle conditions. this is the coil. Now the problem with the coil is that any change in its geometry would be disastrous. Right, so we have to be very careful with this. Trouble is they've sealed it in such a manner that it's difficult to open. There we go. Now, this is supposedly the coil wrapped in a piece of tissue. Okay. Now, what we have here is a little pin has to be pulled out and put back in, and on the coil there's a little hole. Okay. Now, what we do is we withdraw the pin a little bit. Careful not to crack anything. And you see in this coil that everything is nice and clean inside, nothing is cracked, nothing is broken. And this stator and coil should go straight into the stator like this, without any force, without anything, should just drop in. There, it went in all the way. Coil appears to be in the right place now. The coil looks like it's in the right position, so we'll try putting in a rotor, seeing if it goes in. The rotor goes in nicely, comes out easily. So we are on our way, so that looks good. Okay, well, I didn't realize earlier as we're meant to take these out as well. So, is it meant to be screwing or what? Is it meant to be popped out? Let's come out. And then, we have to thread this into position. In the end, I had to take the thing apart and thread it all the way through. I need to cut this to approximately the right length. In any case, it won't fit on anyway, so let's cut. And then try and put this piece back on. I don't manage to get it back on, so I'm going to try freezing the end of this in nitrogen.
Actually, I should never have taken this end of the pipe off. It was quite difficult to get back on, but in the end, it worked.
Then I can put this over here, bring this back up here, hold it. Okay, I hope that is going to work. Okay, now we put the screws back in here. So that's it. So we've got the magic angle working. So what we have to do here is put this on here, having cut it to length, and crimp it so it can't go anywhere. I hope I've got the right tool here. Let's give it a shot, see what happens. Here is a rotor, goes in. Click on insert, wait a few seconds and see if it goes into the right place. It takes 10 seconds now. Right, that's now at the magic angle approximately. Now let's take a look into the rotor and try spinning it. Ah, of course it won't work. Of course it won't work, I have to put these in first. Otherwise, all the air escapes. Okay, let's try again. Now it's going to spin.
The spin rate was not sufficient. It like only span a few tens of hertz. So you can still see the spinning in the video here. So we had to do something.
I have an answer. On the sides, you've got these two pieces of black things. We have to make sure that the holes are in the right direction. I mean, I can twist it around in such a manner that it blocks the flow, and then it won't work. So if it blocks the flow, it won't work, but if it's allowing the flow through, it will work. So we'll give it a shot. So on the left, the flow is blocked. On the right, the flow is hopefully working. We'll see. Set it to 5,000 hertz. And the lever is going to 5,000 hertz. Now the RF test. It's this one I think. I see some signal. There's a signal of some kind. Good, I'll check the photon as well, and that's it. Okay, all that's left now is to put the can back on. And the screws back in. And then we can put it in the magnet and try out to see and start calibrating everything again. Okay, so now we put it back in.
Having repaired the probe, it was now time to do the calibration tests. First up was to put some potassium bromide in and check for the magic angle so that you would get the longest echoes in the FID as shown here. And then there's the turn of the adamantane sample, which we check in high power decoupling to see how good the shimming is, check the shimming, fix the shimming, and fix the magic angle maybe and the tuning. Once that's done, we have to set up the cross-polarization CPMAS parameters. In this case, in Brooker, we're talking about the X-nucleus pulse, in this case carbon, P3, its power PLdB1 or PLW1, its the proton power PLW2, and the decoupler power PLW12, but being careful not to put the decoupling power too high so that there's no arcing. For each of these parameters, we can use the parameter optimization command, POPT, that gives you several attempts showing the peak height and signal strength for each attempt and determining which one is the best. Having done carbon, we then moved on to phosphorus and nitrogen and checked the standards there. And having been satisfied with that, we also did a couple of other nuclei that are common in our lab, that's being silicon 29 and selenium 77. Now, a few days later, the eject pipe came off, so we had to do a further fix on that.
Okay, so the eject came loose. Okay, we'll just put it on with insulating tape. I think it's the easiest, and hope for the best. Now we can check it. Now we have a solid state CPMAS probe working again. If you want to stay updated, please subscribe, press the like button, and order NMR services at the link and in the description below.